The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
My name is Pastor Jennifer, and it's my joy to welcome each and every one of you here to University Baptist Church this morning for worship. We are an inclusive, inquisitive community of faith, and we are grateful that you are here. If you are a guest or a visitor looking to connect more deeply, I'd encourage you to fill out the card in your pew back and drop it off in one of the boxes, either up front or in the back in the welcome area. And that's the way we can get to know you better. That's also how we take up our offering, is through the boxes, or you can scan the QR code in the bulletin and give online. You'll notice in your bulletin today, it's a bit full. We have an insert, and it's all about the ways that you can volunteer here at UBC. We'll let you do anything around here. And so if you'll take a look over the list, we'd love to have some more folks who want to be lay readers. We'll give you instructions. We'll walk you through it. We'll sound check you. If you want to sing in the choir, you don't even have to audition. Ian will just plug you right in. If you want to be an Advent candle lighter when we light the Advent wreath, if you want to plant, and I've already been corrected, pansies, not peonies, out front, we'd love to have you do that. Apparently, peonies don't work well down here. My mistake. Or if you want to help decorate the sanctuary for Christmas, get in the Christmas spirit early, we'd love to have you for that. So I won't read them all, but please take a moment, fill it out, and let us know how you would like to plug in those ways. Also, coming up, we have a pretty big event next Sunday. It's All Saints Sunday. And so following the service, we're going to have mug shots catered. And so it's $10 cash or check. Let us know, though, so we can get that order number right. If you're a college student, good news, you eat free. But you still need to let us know that you're going to be here. We'll have jazz music to kind of celebrate the day. And then we're going to move into the fellowship hall, and our deacons are going to kick off a conversation about who God is calling us to be. And so we promise we'll be done by 2 o'clock. There will be childcare here for people who need it. But it's going to be really important for us as a community to decide what's next for UBC. And so the more voices that we have in the room, the better able we will be to discern. And so this is the first of 4 conversations that will be happening over the next several months. And so we really hope that you'll reach out, invite folks you maybe haven't seen in a while, and that you'll stick around for that. This afternoon, we have the closing of the Women's Art Collective in the gallery at 2 o'clock until 3:30, and the artists will be here. So it'll be a great time for you to chat with them about their work and get to know them and support them in that way. This Thursday, I don't know if you know this, is Halloween. And so our youngish adults are invited to my house, or we're going to do a porch hang. And so last year we had over 500 trick-or-treaters come to our door. And so we'd love for you to help pass out candy. We've got plenty this year. We learned from last year. But we'd love for you to come hang out on our porch, hand out candy. And so let me know if you need more information about that. Also, I'm excited that USM is putting on the Music Man. And so that will be from Thursday until Saturday, I believe, Sunday, Thursday through Sunday. And some of our folks who sing in our choir are involved in that. And so if you want more information about tickets, see Ian, and he will get you all connected for that show. Whew, okay, finally, today is Reformation Sunday. And so you'll notice that Pastor Zach and I have red stoles on, representing the Holy Spirit and the spirit of Reformation that Martin Luther brought about when he nailed those 95 theses to a church door and kicked off an entire new movement called Protestantism. And so as Baptists, we come from that stream of faith where we believe in sola scriptura or prima scriptura. So we believe that scripture is the primary thing and that nobody is between you and God. And so we celebrate that Reformation today as we worship together. So with all of that said, let's take a moment to quiet our minds and our hearts and pay attention to the Spirit of God here among us as we worship and listen to our prelude.
to walk in paths of graciousness and generosity. May we live lives marked by deep commitments to hospitality and service. We gather as one, ready to share our gifts, believing that love calls us to extend welcome to all. Come all who are drawn by the whispers of the divine. Let us trust that God meets us in our work and in our worship. We gather as one with open hearts and willing hands, ready to listen and respond to God's voice in our lives. Let us build heaven here by sheltering the stranger, welcoming the wanderer, and loving the lost. With God's help, we will. Amen.
Please stand as you're able and join us in singing hymn number 52, O Worship the King.
Please join me in prayer. Loving Creator, we gather in your presence, united by the bond of love and grace. As we come together, may our hearts be open and our spirits welcoming, embracing all who enter this sacred space. For in your house, there is room for everyone. Help us to extend the warmth of hospitality, to recognize the beauty of our diversity, and to celebrate the gifts each person brings. May we be a community where every voice is heard, every story is valued, and every heart finds a home. As we worship today, fill us with your joy. Remind us that we belong to you and to one another. May our gathering reflect your love, a sanctuary of hope and acceptance, where all are invited to experience your grace. In the name of Jesus, who welcomes all, amen. Our Old Testament lesson today is Ephesians 2, 14 through 23. I will be reading the version found in the Message. The Messiah has made things up between us so that we're now together on this, both non-Jewish outsiders and Jewish insiders. He tore down the wall we used to keep each other at a distance. He repealed the law code that had become so clogged with fine print and footnotes that it hindered more than it helped. Then he started over. Instead of continuing with two groups of people separated by centuries of animosity and suspicion, he created a new kind of human being, a fresh start for everybody. Christ brought us together through his death on the cross. The cross got us to embrace, and that was the end of the hostility. Christ came and preached peace to you outsiders and peace to us insiders. He treated us as equals and so made us equals. Through him, we both share the same spirit and have equal access to the Father. That's plain enough, isn't it? You're no longer wandering exiles. This kingdom of faith is now your home country. You're no longer strangers or outsiders. You belong here, with as much right to the name Christian as anyone. God is building a home. He's using us all, irrespective of how we got here and what he is building. He used the apostles and prophets for the foundation. Now he's using you, fitting you in brick by brick, stone by stone, with Christ Jesus as the cornerstone that holds all the parts together. We see it taking shape day after day, a holy temple built by God, all of us built into it, a temple in which God is quite at home. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
At this time, I'll invite our children forward for our story for all ages. So I've been thinking a lot about family of God and how many different types of people are in the family of God. And I have some pictures this morning. And so I just wondered, do you think this person would be in the family of God? What do we think? Yeah, we think this person would be. Let's see. Look at this person who's writing. Do we think this person would be in the family of God? Yeah. Here's a fun picture of some kids on a park bench. What do we think? They're going to be in the family of God? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's see. These are kids at camp. Yeah? That's good. What do you think here? Also in the family of God? Yeah? Last picture. What do we think? Yeah, also in the family of God. Well, the truth is everybody is in the family of God because God wants everybody in God's family. And so today, we're going to be talking about a person named Lydia. Have we ever heard of Lydia before? No? Well, Lydia is a really fascinating person. She's her own businesswoman. And so I'm going to read from our Peace Table Bible the story about Lydia. So here's the picture of her, right? What color do you notice that she's wearing? Purple, right? Purple is really important for Lydia. So you see her purple outfit? So Lydia, early each morning, Lydia went to the shores of the Mediterranean Sea in search of shellfish. She needed them to make purple dye for the cloth she sold. Wealthy people came from far and wide to buy her beautiful purple cloth. On the Sabbath, Lydia and her family and her friends went outside the gate of the city to the river. They met there to pray every week. Two men came up and asked to sit with them. It was Paul and Silas, who had recently arrived in Philippi. Paul said, God gave me a vision, telling us to come and share the good news here. And Lydia said, what is this good news? The two men told them about Jesus, the teacher and healer who was the Son of God. Lydia listened eagerly, amazed to learn that God had raised Jesus to life after 3 days in the tomb. The men explained how the followers of Jesus were baptized with water and the Holy Spirit. God opened Lydia's heart. She wanted to be baptized too, along with her family. So Paul and Silas baptized them in the river, right? Filled with joy, Lydia said, please come and stay in my home. So they did. Paul and Silas traveled to other places in the region of Macedonia for some time. Before leaving, they returned to Lydia's house. They encouraged believers from the church, and then they went on their way. So I wonder why Lydia took her family and they prayed at the river. I wonder about that. I wonder if you've ever had a time where you heard something new and you got to learn something new like Lydia did. I wonder if you've ever had an outfit that was really fancy, that was for special occasions, like Lydia's cloth. I have one of those outfits. But the most important thing to remember is that we all belong to the family of God, just like Lydia does. So let's lead our folks in our prayer this morning by saying the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. You may return to your seats.
Please remain standing for our hymn number 614, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart.
What a wonderful change in my life was with God, since Jesus came into my heart. Good morning, church. Before I get started, I would like to make sure you know that we've got someone here with us today. Shane McNary has joined us this morning from our friends at the Great Rivers Fellowship. He helps us make sure that the broader Cooperative Baptist Fellowship family feels local to us. And so we're grateful that he's here with us this morning. I hope before we part company to get today that you'll shake Shane's hand. Today's second scripture lesson comes from Acts chapter 16, verses 11 through 15, and verse 40. You'll find it on page 1279 in your pew Bible. "We therefore set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city in the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, 'If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home.' And she prevailed upon us." Verse 40 goes like this. "After leaving the prison, they went to Lydia's home. And when they had seen and encouraged the brothers and sisters there, they departed. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God." Today's second scripture reading recounts the story of Paul's arrival in Philippi during his second missionary journey and introduces us to Lydia, the final person whose story we'll explore together as part of our Bold and Untold sermon series. I hope you've enjoyed this sermon series. I know even on the tail end of 3 years of seminary, I've learned a lot about these characters that we've discussed over the past few weeks. Here in this story, Paul and his companions, which likely included Silas, Timothy, and Luke, travel from a port city in Asia Minor to Philippi in Macedonia. So think from modern-day Turkey to modern-day Greece. The scriptures describe Philippi as a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. This designation underscores Philippi's significance, as it held a prestigious status within the Roman Empire. A Roman colony had certain privileges. Its citizens were exempt from some taxes, followed Roman laws, and maintained a degree of autonomy, making it a culturally and politically strategic place for Paul to establish an early Christian community. Paul and his team wait until the Sabbath to seek a place of prayer. As there may not have been a synagogue in Philippi, often the case in Roman colonies, the group goes outside the city gate to a riverbank, a common gathering place for those observing the Sabbath in regions with smaller Jewish communities. Here, Paul and his team meet a group of women who are gathered to pray. Among these women is Lydia, introduced as a merchant of purple cloth from Thyatira, a city renowned for its dyes and textiles. Purple cloth was valuable and expensive, indicating that Lydia was likely affluent and independent, a rarity for women in that period. She's also described as a worshiper of God in our text, meaning that she was likely a Gentile woman who respected the Jewish faith and observed certain aspects of it. As Paul shares the gospel, the text tells us that the Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. After hearing Paul's message, Lydia makes a significant decision. She's baptized, along with her entire household. Baptism in the early church, as today, was both a sign of faith and an entrance into the Christian community, indicating her wholehearted acceptance of Paul's message and her desire to be part of this new faith movement. The inclusion of her household in the baptism also shows her influence as a leader within her family. and community, especially since it was unusual for women to head a household in this era. Following her baptism, Lydia extends an invitation to Paul and his companions, and this is where we're going to kind of camp out today. She extends an invitation for them to stay at her house, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." This invitation is significant on a couple of levels. First, it shows Lydia's generosity and her desire to use her resources to support the work of the gospel. Second, it illustrates the early Christian value of hospitality, which was essential to the growth of the early Christian movement. Houses like Lydia's became centers for the first Christian gatherings, where new believers could meet and pray and encourage one another. Paul and his companions accept her invitation. I think it reads that she was persuasive. They accept her invitation, making her home one of the earliest known meeting places for Christians in what we know today as Europe. After Lydia's conversion, Paul and Silas continue their ministry in Philippi, but soon encounter opposition. You know this story, leading to their imprisonment. Through a miraculous release, they are freed, and before leaving the city, they return to Lydia's house. Acts chapter 16, verse 40 notes that they encouraged the brothers and sisters before departing, which shows that a small community of believers had formed in Philippi by this time. Lydia's home becomes a hub of fellowship, prayer, and encouragement, making her one of the earliest supporters of Paul's mission and a pillar of the Philippian church. Her role exemplifies how individuals who were often marginalized, such as women and Gentiles, became central to the spread of the early Christian movement. Her faith and hospitality had a ripple effect, laying a foundation for a church community in Philippi that would later, of course, receive one of Paul's most affectionate letters, which we read in our beloved New Testament epistles. This past week, I found myself reflecting on the impact that small acts of welcome and embrace can have, and the propensity of these small acts to turn into part of significant movements of radical hospitality. As I did so, my mind, as it often does, wandered off to my home state. Clarkston, it turns out Georgia is often on my mind. Clarkston, Georgia is called the most diverse square mile in America. It's sometimes been referred to as the Ellis Island of the South. For about 14,000 people, it is home. For decades, Clarkston's paved roads were few and its goat farmers many. When Interstate 285, which encircles Metro Atlanta, was completed in 1969, Clarkston developed into one of Atlanta's earliest bedroom communities, just east of the I-285 perimeter. In the mid-1970s, Clarkston began seeing its first refugees, part of a wave of 300,000 Southeast Asian migrants who entered our country, due largely to the U.S. Attorney General's parole authority in the 5 years following the fall of Saigon. As Congress grasped the scale of its refugee migration, it passed the Refugee Act of 1980, to standardize resettlement services for all refugees entering the country. The U.S. then formally adopted the United Nations definition of refugee, someone who has been forced to flee their country because of persecution, war, or violence, someone who has a well-founded fear of persecution for reasons of race, religion, nationality, political opinion, or membership in a particular social group. As many white residents fled farther out to more fashionable developing Atlanta suburbs, Clarkston became perfect for refugees, with its hundreds of vacated apartments and access to public transportation, a post office, and a grocery store, all within walking distance. This little city became one of now 190 designated resettlement communities across the country. And so here came Somalis fleeing civil war, Bhutanese fleeing ethnic cleansing, Eritreans and Liberians, Croatians and Cambodians, and all who make up the now 100 different ethnic groups who have begun their American stories in Clarkston, Georgia. Their stories all start with persecution. Some are political asylees who have sought protection by submitting an asylum application in the United States after their arrival here. Most, though, are refugees who have undergone intense and extensive processes to settle in our country. In total, some 60,000 refugees have called Clarkston and its nearby neighborhoods their first American home. That's about 2,000 per year on average since 1980. A fraction of a fraction of a fraction of the world's refugees live or have lived in Clarkston. And yet refugees have put this Georgia city on the map. Together, people in this small city have built a patchwork community of almost unfathomable diversity. Across chasms of difference, all sorts of people have found sincere belonging and given new life and energy to a town that had largely been abandoned. A small act of welcome turned into a significant movement of radical hospitality. Today's passage about Lydia, who opened her home to Paul and Silas, is more than just a story of Christian nicety. It's a story of boldness, a story of courage, and a story of someone who longs to belong to something greater than herself. And through her actions, we see a shift from simple welcome to true belonging, a powerful shift when lived out has the potential to change our world. When Lydia invited Paul and Silas to stay with her, she wasn't just offering a place to sleep. She was asking them a question, though it wasn't a question spoken aloud. Lydia, a wealthy, independent woman in a male-dominated society, was effectively asking, "Do you believe that I can truly belong to this family of God you are preaching about?" Imagine the courage it took for Lydia to make this invitation. Here was a woman, a Gentile, a merchant of luxury goods, drawn to the faith of Israel but not fully belonging to it. When she encountered Paul and heard about Jesus, something stirred within her. She felt that this God who transcended nations and peoples was calling her too. But there was still the question, would this community of believers truly welcome her? Her invitation was a way of saying, if you see me as part of the family, if you believe I belong, come and stay with me. Her bold request asked them to affirm her place in this new, diverse, boundary-breaking community of faith. And in doing so, Lydia was inviting Paul and Silas into something larger, a vision of community that is radically inclusive, not only in word, but in action. Lydia's story challenges us as a church today. We often say we are an inclusive church, but what does it mean to go beyond a broad welcome toward true affirmation and celebration of each person who walks through our doors? It means moving from merely saying, "You can sit with us," to actively building a table where everyone is host, where every voice is heard, and where all people are celebrated for the unique image of God within them. It means being a church that says to every person who enters, "You don't just have a place here. You have an essential part in shaping who we are." Lydia didn't just want to be accepted. She wanted to belong. Sincerely belong. She wanted the affirmation that her presence mattered. And that's what we're called to offer. Not only to be people who say, "Come and see what God is doing in our midst," but people who say, "Come and be part of what God is doing with us." If we are to learn from Lydia, we need to embrace the call to go beyond just welcoming people from different from ourselves. We need to go out of our way to truly enter their world, to be with them, and to become part of their lives. Paul and Silas didn't just stay in Lydia's home. They entered into her life, her context, her world. and in doing so, they affirmed her faith and her identity as part of God's family. Imagine a church where everyone sought to truly know each other's lives, not only to greet each other warmly, but to enter into each other's struggles, joys, and stories. This is not easy. It takes intentionality, vulnerability, and an openness to change. But it is the way of Christ, the Christ we follow, who ate with tax collectors, touched lepers, and called fishermen to be his closest friends. This is the way of the one who, rather than inviting us to merely come close to heaven, brought heaven to us. That town we were talking about earlier, Clarkston, their journey hasn't been all smooth sailing. There have been those locally who have resisted change and preferred that those settling in the area assimilate thoroughly to American culture. But assimilation is an odd beast. It forces forgetting. It craves a compression of culture. And the melting pot it stews serves up something hard for many to swallow. Living in a nation of immigrants means living in the tension between moving forward and looking back. Clarkston, at times a close acquaintance of this beast of assimilation, at times its nemesis, knows this deep, deep in its bones. And so locals acknowledge that they've still got a lot to learn, though they've been at this now for decades. Against all odds, though, something beautiful has happened as the city welcomed so many newcomers. Clarkston began to transform. New businesses, restaurants, and markets emerged. The city's schools embraced multiple languages, and the neighborhoods became places of rich cultural exchange. Clarkston's journey was complicated and fraught, but over the years, the people of this small Georgia city learned that each person who arrived brought something essential to the life of their community. They became more than just a welcoming city. They became a city transformed by the diversity of those who lived there. UBC, as we are we prepared to be transformed by those finding fellowship among us? Are we prepared to move from commitments to welcome and inclusion toward truly affirming and celebrating the image of God in all people? What do we mean when we say you belong? Is it enough to ask people to come to us, welcoming them into our pews? Are we willing to go to them, becoming part of their worlds? Friends, we enter into congregational conversations, as Pastor Jennifer shared with us earlier. Next Sunday, following worship, as part of the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship's initiative called Dawnings. Dawnings is a spiritual formation process designed to help congregations discover and live into God's vision for their community, created around the idea that churches are called to listen, discern, and respond to God's leading. Dawnings provides tools and a framework which we'll utilize to step back from our day-to-day rhythms and consider our broader calling and purpose. Through Dawnings, we'll work together to be more attentive, adaptive, and faithful to our unique calling as a gathered people. We will seek God's direction to ultimately live into a renewed sense of mission and vision as a church. Along the way, we'll engage two primary questions. Lord, who are you calling us to be? And what are you calling us to do? As we engage these questions together, I hope we'll recall what Lydia's story teaches us. God calls us to be a community where every person belongs, where welcome is extended freely and affirmation is given wholeheartedly. This calling isn't just a passive invitation. It's an active choice to seek out and celebrate each person as an integral part of our church family. Likewise, God calls us to move toward radical love, even when it requires us to leave our comfort zones and enter into each other's spaces, each other's lives. To truly love one another means not only welcoming, but becoming fully present in one another's lives, learning each other's stories, sharing each other's burdens, and celebrating each other's joys. In practice, this might look like showing up for the refugees in our pews, advocating for those who've been told time and again that they are just beyond the reach of God's love, and walking alongside those who seek sincere belonging. It could mean reaching out to the person who feels out of place in our midst, saying not only you are welcome here, but also you are deeply valued and celebrated here for precisely who you are. In the spirit of Lydia's question, I hope we'll consider how we respond to those around us, especially those who might ask, like Lydia did, can I really belong here? Let us be the kind of church that moves beyond polite hospitality to a full-throated affirmation of the image of God in all people, where every person who walks through our doors feels not only welcomed, but deeply loved. Let us be a people who, like Paul and Silas, are also willing to be seen with those who are different, to enter into their homes, stories, and lives as a means of knowing and supporting them. May we consider this calling, our unique calling, with courage, continually asking ourselves, Lord, who are you calling us to be? What are you calling us to do? On this Reformation Sunday, I pray that we'll recommit ourselves to continual reformation, unending change, by the guiding of the Spirit, who's with us each step of the way. If we will, I think we might just find ourselves transformed, becoming a people known for building a community where everyone knows they belong, without any need for churchly assimilation in the family of God. Amen. Friends, each week at the conclusion of worship, we come to a time of response. This is your opportunity to share that you'd like to make this church community your home, or perhaps that you'd like to walk in the way of Jesus. If either of these are decisions that you would like to make, I'd ask you to come forward now as we sing our hymn of commitment, number 587, Amazing Grace. Receive this spoken benediction. As we end this form of worship to begin the worship that is our very lives, go believing you are beloved, counting yourself as included, and knowing that you have been called to tend to God's work of love. Amen.